Welcome to Speaking of Science. The National Institute of Mental Health presents a series of conversations with innovative researchers working in a wide range of disciplines to pave the way for the prevention, recovery, and cure of mental illness.
This is the first in a series of conversations with individuals who come for talks here at the NIMH, particularly within our innovation series. And we're delighted today to have Dr. Robert Sapolsky, who is a professor at Stanford University with a long history of research in neurobiology and psychobiology, including a great tradition of field studies in human and non-human primatology. One of the things we're hearing about a lot is the idea that stress could leave a sort of a footprint that you could find years later. You mentioned before that stress during fetal life or early in development can sort of set up a pattern in terms of metabolic homeostasis or put somebody at risk, for instance, for diabetes later. Is there a way that you could begin to look at that? Is there a footprint that would be present biologically that you could take out a blood sample from someone or look at their genome and figure out that this is a person who has been scarred by a particular exposure during fetal life or early in development, and even do that years later? Are there tools for that?
You got your genes that produce proteins, and rather than this picture of genes being autonomously running the whole show, there are switches for them, turning them on and off at appropriate times, and there are mechanisms in which events in the environment can, in effect, freeze some of these switches on or freeze them off. And what is now beginning to be realized is some of these ways in which early experience can play out in the whole lifetime is in ways of, if not disabling certain genes, certainly making it harder to use them in the future, or conversely over-activating some of them. Stress has a means to gum up some of the switches for long after.
And so those are things you could actually detect and begin to see, basically like a footprint or a fossil. You could say, somebody has actually got the residue of an experience.
Or maybe even an apter term would be scar tissue. Molecular scar tissue of your adversities.
What allows some people to cope better than others? And what are the things that any of us can take from the biological literature, from how through evolution coping takes place, that might be of value for us to remember during tough times? I think it was only last night that the president said, how do we turn ordeal into opportunity? So what's your thought about the opportunities for coping?
Well, again, if we're distinguishing between the world of these are stressful times, I'm going to wind up on the street, versus these are stressful times in a purely psychosocial way of concentrating on the latter, it's turfing back to this world of fewer of these stressors will shorten our life expectancy. Fewer of these stressors will lead our bones to be scattered on the savanna while predators pick over the leftovers. Instead, they are psychosocial inventions. And there's the potential to very powerfully manipulate the psychosocial settings. Again, for the same external misery, you're more likely to subjectively feel stressed, more likely to activate a stress response, more likely to get a stress-related disease if you feel like you have no control over what's going on, if you feel like you have no predictive information, when is it coming, how long is it going to last, how bad is it going to be, if you are set up to interpret things as getting worse, if you lack outlets for the frustration, and if you lack somebody's shoulder to cry on, social support. And to the extent that one has to fall back on homilies, you know, give me the wisdom to tell the difference between what I can change and what I can't, you don't want to try to control the uncontrollable. You don't want to try to control something that's already occurred. But within the realm where it is realistic, little footholds of control can be enormously helpful. Understanding which outlets are most efficacious, understanding that above all else we are a social primate, and the support derived by that, you know, it again potentially sounds platitudinous, but these are, when they're varying, when they're manipulating an order of magnitude, some of the biological outcomes to these things, these are no mere platitudes.
Is there a difference between men and women in terms of vulnerability?
There is, in a lot of realms, and not surprisingly, it's a complex and often contentious field. In lots of ways, where some of the most important differences play out biologically are the ways in which testosterone is not a hormone you necessarily want to have around for your cardiovascular system, for example, and the ways in which estrogen is often a very desirable hormone to have around. So that's a big difference, and that certainly plays out in terms of, for example, some of the vulnerability to growth disorders during chronic stress. There are some gender differences. Where the most meaningful sex differences come from, I think, is more at the psychological end, the psychosocial end. And this is, you know, potentially barreling into all sorts of cliches, but one that nevertheless are supported by the literature. Women are far better on the average at taking advantage of social support and social outlets than are men on the average, and particularly so during aging and the responses to stressors at that point. That's an area where there's big differences in coping skills, emotional expressivity, interdependence, you know, all that sort of stuff, very striking differences.
What's been the most helpful, and you're trying to understand the vicissitudes of human psychobiology?
I would say, you know, this is going to be fairly undefined, but just realizing the extent to which all this biology and neurobiology and even neurogenetics and all this cutting-edge stuff, the extent to which it makes no sense outside of the context of environment and experience and how some of the most interesting parts of the brain are exquisitely shaped by the world around you, and the extent to which the genetics of stress and psychiatric disorders are the genetics of vulnerability rather than inevitability, and that it's actually possible to start understanding how this works.
Thank you very much for joining us. This has been a really terrific conversation. A lot of the work you're doing currently, which is veering off into a new realm of looking at the role of parasites in regulating the stress response and regulating behavior, is going to open up a whole new door. We'll have to have you back at some point to talk even more about that. Well, thank you.
Thanks.